Hey everyone! The Flipper Zero uses GPIO signals, like the ones shown here, to interface with various hardware. In this video, we'll look at the Flipper Zero code to produce these signals. We'll start by looking at some ways to achieve the toggle signal, and then we'll move on to pulse width modulation. If you haven't already, I recommend you watch my first video where I discuss signal concepts such as toggle and PWM, as well as other timer concepts. Let's get started! The code in this video comes from my Flipper Zero wiki on GPIO signals. The first technique is called bit banging. On line 5, you can see we're initializing GPIO pin A7 for push-pull output. And on line 4, we write a true to pin 7 to avoid a little glitch when we do the initialization. Line 6 is a for loop, and that's going to run 10 times the code that's on lines 7 through 10. Line 7 writes a true to pin A7, setting that pin to 3.3 volts. We then delay for 400 milliseconds. Then we write a false to pin A7, which is going to pull that to 0 volts. And we delay for another 400 milliseconds. This loops 10 times, causing those 400 millisecond pulses. On line 14, we reinitialize the pin A7 to be analog input, which helps prevent accidental shorts. I connected the logic analyzer to pins A7 and ground, which is what we're using in this video. We'll go ahead and run the application, and you can see the 10 pulses are getting received. And you can see that the lows and these highs are each 401 milliseconds in duration. And that's because the instructions and the delay also takes time to execute. This example still uses bit banging, but on line 7, you can see we're writing directly to pin A7's port BSRR register. The value is pin A7 shifted by the set position, BS0. And this is the same as writing true earlier. So our pin will get 3.3 volts. On line 9, we're also writing to the same BSRR register, but this time we shift by the reset position, BR0, and this will give you the ground or 0 volts. You should generally use the previous method for controlling GPIO because it's easier to read, but still this technique can come in handy if you need to write directly to registers, such as the BSRR register. We'll run the app, and again we'll notice that we're going to get our 10 pulses. And again, you'll notice each toggles about 401 milliseconds. So in this example, I've changed our delay to be Fruit delay microseconds, 399989. And you can see that now our time is a lot closer to the 400 millisecond target we were looking for. In this next example, we're using timer 1 to control pin A7. At the end of line 5, you can see that we're using the alternate function 1 timer 1. Line 6 enables the bus for timer 1. I'm going to assume you've watched my previous video about the timers. So on line 8, you can see we've configured the timer to count up. We've set our divisor to 1. Our prescaler is 64,000. And on line 15, you can see we're using the internal clock, which is 64 megahertz, which means we're getting a tick 1,000 times a second. Our auto reload is 400 minus 1, so every 400 ticks, we're going to have the event happen. On line 18, we specified that we're using toggle, not PWM. And on line 24, we're using timer 1's channel 1N, which is what's connected to pin A7. On line 24, we enable the channel, and then we enable the counter, and then we enable all outputs. And at that point, our Flipper Zero will start toggling pin A7 at 400 milliseconds. On line 40, we call this code, which starts toggling the pin, and then we sleep for 4 seconds while we're getting those toggles, and then we call toggle done, which uninitializes the GPIO and stops the counters and outputs and disables the bus. And we'll go ahead and run that code, which is going to run for 4 seconds, getting these 400 millisecond pulses. And you can see those pulses are fairly close to 400 milliseconds. With OC mode toggle, we just toggle back and forth based on the value in the auto reload. Next, we'll look at pulse width modulation, which allows for different duty cycles. We can use FRUI HAL PWM start and specify the pin, the frequency in hertz, and the duty cycle. If the duty cycle was 50%, this would be the same as toggle. We'll go ahead and run the app. And you can see that there's a 1 millisecond glitch at the very beginning, but then we have 125 hertz signal with the 25% duty cycle. So if your frequency is an integer and you don't care about the initial glitch, then this API probably works great for you. So next we have the code for using timer 1 in PWM 1 mode. This code is similar to the toggle code we looked at earlier. Our prescaler is 64,000 minus 1, and our auto reload is 8 minus 1. So we'll get an event every 8 milliseconds. On line 23, we're using OC mode PWM 1 instead of toggle, and we set our compare value to 2. So out of the 8 ticks, we'll be on for the first 2 and then off for the rest. So we'll have a 25% duty cycle. So on line 48, we'll go ahead and set up that pulse width modulation signal. We'll sleep for 1 second and then we'll call the done just like before. So we'll go ahead and run the app and there's our pulse for 1 second. And when we zoom in, we can see our 25% with our 2 milliseconds on out of the 8 milliseconds total. Next, we're using direct memory access. And on line 9, you can see we're using timer 1's CCR1. And this is the same as the compare value we were looking at earlier to specify the duty cycle. Line 10, no increment, means that every time we write to here, we'll write to that same CCR1 address. And data align word means we're writing 32-bit values. The values that we'll be reading are from the duty cycles array. Every time we read a value, we'll do an increment to the next value. There are also 32-bit values. Line 15, mode circular, means when we get to the end of the array, we'll loop back to the beginning of the array. And MB data specifies that there's 4 values in our array. Every time timer 1 completes, we'll execute this DMA command. Line 20 and 21 specify that this is using DMA 1 and channel 1 of DMA 1. The pulse width modulation code is basically the same as before. On line 41, that compare value is going to get overwritten by our DMA buffer. And we added lines 50 through 52 because of DMA. Our done code is similar to before, but we also disabled the DMA request update and we disabled the DMA channel channels that we've used. We'll go ahead and run that app, and we should be looking for those duty cycles of 2, 4, 6, and 3. So there's 2, there's 4, there's 6, and there's 3. And then again, the next, we see 2, 4, 6, and 3. In this next example, on line 9, you can see we're using timer 1's ARR register. And this is that auto reload register that we count up to. And we're going to put the timer in toggle mode this time. And since auto reload starts at 0, all of our durations on line 4 have a minus 1 after them. On line 40, you can see we're using OC mode toggle. And on line 33, we're setting auto reload, although direct memory access will override that with values from our buffer. Our toggle done code is the same as the PWM done code before. And we'll go ahead and run our app. And you can see the timings are 2, 6, 4, 2, 6, 5, 2, which is the same as the timing specified on line 4. So this is super powerful because we're able to make arbitrary waveforms now with whatever durations we need. So this last example is fairly complicated, but it's basically how we can have a modulated signal that we're turning on and off. So on line 10, you can see we have an off signal, which is forced inactive, where the signal's just not happening on the GPIO pin, but it is happening in the timer. And then otherwise, we're using PWM2 mode, which kind of inverts the logic compared to PWM1 mode. On line 15, you can see we're using timer's 1 RCR register, which is the repetition counter of how many times it's going to send the same signal before the event happens. Our buffer on line 18 is going to use the same buffer from line 5, which has that 3, 5, 6, 5, 9, 5 pattern. And this is using DMA channel 1. And then on DMA channel 2, on line 31, you can see we're using timer 1's CCMR1, which is the compare mode that's going to go between inactive in PWM2. And on line 37, we've configured that to be circular. So we're going to keep toggling between having an active signal and having an inactive signal. So on line 55, you can see our auto reload is 20 minus 1. Line 63, our compare value is 10. So we're going to have a 50% duty cycle. On line 62, we're going to be overriding this using our DMA buffer, switching between inactive and PWM2. Our done code is the same as before, except for we do DMA disable channel for both DMA channel 1 and channel 2 of DMA 1. So we'll go ahead and run that code, and you can see we're getting pulses of 3, 6, and 9 with gaps equal to 5 pulses worth of gap. Hopefully now you know how to write the Flipper Zero code to create different signals. Please like and subscribe. And if you have any questions about how to make a particular signal, please post a message over in my Discord channel and I'll be happy to help you.